Hey guys, Pastor Mike here at Connection Christian Church. So tonight I just got back from Grand Island. I went there to watch my daughter play basketball. Now, this is her first year really of playing basketball. She did play one other year a number of years ago, but it was all kind of new to her. So as she got out there the very first time, she definitely had a lot of distance between her and the other players. There were some other things that she wasn't doing all that well as well. And so tonight I'm proud to say that after we've gone through some things, after she has sat underneath her coaches for a little bit, I noticed a number of improvements in her basketball game. And the reason I say that is because I want to talk to you about obedience. Obedience is a very important thing in our Christian walk, but really just in everything that we do. And before we really hit that hard, let's pray it up. And then we're going to dive into Exodus here a little bit. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to get into your word, to understand it, and to apply it in our life. Help us to understand what you're talking about here in this passage and how it can apply to us today. And help us to be obedient to your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're in Exodus 37 and 38. And what we see in Exodus 37 and 38 is really almost a redundancy, a repetition of things that we've already talked about. Matter of fact, we hit just in the last time that I did a Devo, Exodus 25, and talking about some of the different elements that exist within the tabernacle, that is the portable church that they had constructed. So if we go back to 25, we see that God is giving some very specific instructions to Moses, and Moses is therefore to pass them on, and so they're going to build these elements in a particular way with particular materials, and they're going to use specific craftsmen to do that. And God has just laid out this plan, and then we come up to Exodus chapter 37, and I'm just going to read the first nine verses for us here. Bezalel made the ark of acacia wood. 2 cubits and a half was its length, 1.5 cubits its breadth, and 1.5 cubits its height. And he overlaid it with pure gold inside and outside. And he made a molding of the gold around it. And he cast for it 4 rings of gold for its 4 feet. 2 rings on its one side, and 2 rings on its other side. And he made poles of acacia wood and overlaid them with gold. And he put the poles into the rings on the sides of the ark so that they could carry the ark. And he made a mercy seat of pure gold. 2.5 cubits was its length, 1.5 cubits its breadth. And he made 2 cherubim of gold. He made them of hammered work on the 2 ends of the mercy seat. 1 cherub on the one end, and 1 cherub on the other end. Of 1 piece with the mercy seat, he made the cherubim on its 2 ends. The cherubim spread out their wings above, overshadowing the mercy seat with their wings. With their faces one to another, toward the mercy seat were the faces of the cherubim. Now, the reason I read that is because if we go back to Exodus chapter 25, we're going to see God's instructions to Moses, and that something so amazing happens right here, that this Bezalel, he did exactly what he was instructed to do, right? This is like a mind-blowing experiment. You know, here is the instructions, and this is what you should do. Now, any of you who are bosses and you have employees underneath you, this is what you want, right? You want to be able to lay out, here's the instructions, now go. And you just trust that they actually do it. Any of you who are our parents, right? Or who have a spouse, right? It applies about anywhere with about anything. It applies on the basketball court, like I was talking about earlier, and it applies on the home front. See, this is what needs to get done. These are the instructions to do it. Not go into it. And we probably all have thought that we could do something without the instructions, without following them. And sometimes it works out. I love to cook that way. Sometimes it works out. But sometimes it doesn't, right? I love to open up a box of something and try to put it together. And sometimes that works out without following the instructions, but sometimes it doesn't. And sometimes we try to do the same thing with our faith. We try to just go through life and we say, I believe in God, but then we don't really apply the things that God wants us to do. Now, if we were to read through chapters 37 and 38, which we're not going to do, because like I said, it's a redundancy, we're going to see much the same. So the making of the ark, the making of the table, the making of the lampstand, just reading the headings here, the making of the altar of incense, the making of the altar of burnt offering, the making of the bronze basin and the materials for the tabernacle. All of this has already been covered, but now it's being applied. All of this stuff that we gain from God's word is pointless if we don't actually listen to God and do what he says. I'm going to take you to another passage. This is found in the New Testament. It's actually in 1 John, John being one of the disciples of Jesus. It says in chapter 2 of 1 John, and I'll be reading in verse 4, whoever says I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar. Wow. So I claim to know Christ. I claim to follow him, or as we word it, he is my Lord and my Savior. I'm a Christian. I go to church. I read my Bible. Well, most of the time, right? But if we claim Christ, but don't do what he says, we don't follow his commands, then we are a liar. I don't know if that offends you, if it upsets you in the least, but it should. Right? I think it should upset all of us because we all find these times where we know exactly what it is that God wants us to do and we simply do not do it. We get ticked at our employees, at our students, at our kids, and many other people who do exactly what we do to God. They know what they need to do, and they don't do it. Let's continue reading. And the truth is not in him, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. When we keep the commandments, the love of God is perfected in us. By this we may know we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. We do the things that Jesus did. We obey the things that Jesus obeyed. That's what it means to be a Christian, right? To follow Christ. Are you a follower of Christ, or do you just identify with a socially acceptable gospel? Because if you do, if you just embrace a shallow form of Christianity, then you're missing the true depth of the gospel, and you're missing obedience. And I can tell you that one of the reasons we don't understand the Word of God and greater revelation of God is because many times we fail to obey the things that we do understand. Guys, I don't know what it is for you. I don't know where you're rebelling against God. But chances are you've opened up the Bible. You've went to church. You've heard a sermon. You've been in a Bible study. And we go, well, I just don't agree with that. And as a pastor, I can tell you, without a shadow of a doubt, take it up with the big man. Right? Francis Chan has this quote. I've seen it come across social media a couple times, and I would completely agree with it. You know, if ever I'm reading the Word of God and I find something I don't agree with, I have to assume that I'm the one that's wrong. Right? Because God is the one that's shaping me, not the other way around. How is it that you need to live in greater obedience to God? Father, help us to see that, to understand it, to repent of that rebellious attitude. And Father, give us the strength and the wisdom to walk in obedience that we can see and experience a greater love with you, that we would be more and more like Christ. And it's in His name that we pray. Amen. Hey guys, have a great day.